So hi everyone, after a long time I'm going to see you back. So today's topic is about amoebic liver abscess. So let's move to the epidemiology. So amoebiasis is a disease, okay? It is most commonly seen in tropical and then in developing countries like India, okay? So as we know, people are more fond of reading NEET question bank for all the subjects before they're entering into the internship also. So we will be discussing some important NEET questions along with this today's theory topic, okay? So in amoebiasis, there is a question, okay? Amoebic liver abscess is seen in tropical countries, option A. B is developing countries, option B. Option C will be developed countries, and option D is all of the above, okay? So what will be your answer? Okay, I'll tell the amoebiasis is seen in tropical countries, second, developing countries like India, Africa, and it is also seen in developed countries. Now you'll ask me a question, how come the amoebiasis is most commonly seen in developed countries? Okay, as we know, people travel from one place to other because of their job or because of a tourism trip, okay, that we are going to plan. So there is a travel between a developed country and a developing country. For example, a person from Africa starts traveling to America for a job, okay, and he settles there. Okay, for some time, and then he comes back to Africa. Or as a person from India is going to a developed country like UK for a tourism, he just travels inside the UK for a week and then he comes back to India. Okay, so this is two scenarios. We can see if at all the patient is going to have an amoebiasis, the patient is going to make a transmission of disease into a developed country. So therefore, the option you're going to choose in your NEET question will be D, all of the above. Therefore, amoebiasis is a disease most commonly seen in tropical developing countries as well as in developed countries. It is mainly because of immigration and because of a travel between countries. So next question is, what is the causative organism of amoebic liver abscess? It is always Entamoeba histolytica. Or I'm going to repeat it. Entamoeba histolytica is a causative organism mainly seen in amoebic liver abscess. Okay. So next question is going to be, is Entamoeba histolytica endemic in Mexico, Africa, and India? Yes, it is an endemic organism in Mexico, India, and Africa. So next category is, the next question, who are the people going to be most commonly be affected for amoebiasis? Okay. Usually, we can see the person who is an alcoholic can usually get an easy chance of amoebiasis, which can be transferred into an amoebic liver abscess. The second category will be a patient who is having an alcoholic liver cirrhosis or a non-alcoholic liver cirrhosis can also easily get amoebic liver abscess. Okay, so the amoebiasis usually have a different kind of presentations in the body. Okay, so most common extra-intestinal presentation of amoebiasis is nothing but amoebic liver abscess. So the other question is, what is the other name for amoebic liver abscess? Okay, so since it is most commonly seen in tropical countries, it got a name as tropical abscess. So the most common NEET questions we have covered today is the most common organism for amoebic liver abscess is Entamoeba histolytica. The second thing is, it is mainly seen in tropical developing countries and then developing countries. The third thing is, it is most commonly seen in alcoholics. It is also seen in alcoholic liver cirrhosis as well as non-alcoholic liver cirrhosis. The last point we are going to discuss about the epidemiology is amoebic liver abscess is also known as tropical abscess. Okay, I think we are ready right now for the introduction. So thing is, usually in liver, we can see two varieties of abscess. One can be a pyogenic, one can be an amoebic. Okay. So as we know, usually amoebic abscess is mainly seen in endemic areas like India and Africa, which can be more common than the pyogenic abscess. Okay. The pyogenic abscess is more common in which place? It is more common in Western countries, that is in developed countries. Okay. So usually, okay, I'm going to tell you, there's a patient with abscess. What comes to your mind? Always you get a point of, you get a point like there is always a yellowish pus discharge, which can be sticky in nature. Okay, and we always think about what we'll think about. Always abscess has an abscess wall, right? So now today's topic, amoebic liver abscess, always remember it is a sterile one unless it is infected. Okay, so usually you think of the patient is having a liver abscess. Okay, usually think of two varieties, pyogenic as well as amoebic. The amoebic is differentiated from pyogenic with only one criteria, because it is sterile, okay, unless it is infected. Okay, in liver abscess, like pyogenic liver abscess, it could be a pussy one, like it can be pus. Okay. Or else it can also have some kind of discharge, like hemorrhagic also can be present. Okay. It is according to the causative organism causing it. Okay. So I'm telling amoebic liver abscess is usually sterile. It is not so much pus, okay, inside it. Okay. Then what you're going to do with the abscess wall? Anyway, you're going to take it out. Okay. That is our main aim when you're going to do an incision and drainage in any normal scenarios, right? So for example, if you're going to take a wall of the abscess from amoebic liver abscess, what you can see in it? You can see trophozoites of Entamoeba histolytica. So this is how you will think of amoebic liver abscess. It is always, you do an FNAC, we can see it is a sterile one, unless it is infected, okay? And also see, I am going to remove the bits and pieces of the amoebic liver abscess wall, and then I'm going to take and see into a microscope. I can see trophozoites of the Entamoeba histolytica on the walls of the abscess. But for example, I have taken a sterile, okay, drainage of an amoebic liver abscess. So will it have a trophozoite? Most commonly, you cannot see any trophozoites in the content of the abscess. Okay, it is mainly seen on the walls. Always remember, like, the trophozoites will be hanging around the walls of the abscess and not inside the content. Okay. amoebic liver abscess infection is most commonly seen in cecum. So if there is an abscess in a particular region, there should be a transmission, right? Somebody has to go and give the transmission. Like, for example, I have to go and give a disease to a person nearby, okay? And there should be proper channel. It should be through a proper channel, right? So the infection occurs mainly in cecum through a superior mesenteric vein and portal vein, okay? The mode of transmission or the proper channel is by superior mesenteric vein and portal vein, okay? Therefore, after the entry of this entema histolytica into the cecum, it always ends up in the inflammation of the cecum. So therefore, we can see inflammation of the cecum. Okay, so I'm telling always cecum is most commonly affected in amoebic liver abscess. So always we should think of first most common, second most common, and third most common according to the new questions, right? So we have to start thinking about the first most common amoebic liver abscess is mainly seen in cecum because of the SMV, that is superior mesenteric, superior mesenteric wing and portal wing. Okay, the second thing we can also see that there is an infection sigmoid and colon. So this is the second most common, which is mostly through the channel of inferior mesenteric wing and portal wing, okay, which travels to the liver. Okay, so I can ask you, why portal vein? Everywhere you can see portal vein in both the conditions, right? Why portal vein? Because of the streamline effect, okay? There's a streamline effect in the portal vein. And you can also see, for example, there should be, there are two channels, which is very small and which is very bigger, okay? So the bigger channel gives more infection to a particular area, the smaller channels give smaller infection rate, right? So therefore, always remember portal vein is very big, okay? Very big. Why I'm telling this? Okay, this has an anatomical reason because usually the portal vein has a streamline effect as well as it is having a direct connection with the right branch. Okay, and the largest size of the liver is always the right lobe. So therefore, right lobe is also commonly affected over the posterior superior surface. Okay, so now we have seen that the infection has got into the liver. Okay, so will it be a one pack bacill, like for example, a single pack of abscess, like a large cystic or a giant cell abscess, or it's going to be a multiloculated? So always remember, it can be a single large abscess or a multiloculated abscess. Okay, so always remember, as we have seen before, it is most commonly seen in the cecum through superior mesenteric vein and portal vein, and therefore it ends up in the inflammation of the cecum. Okay, second thing, there is going to be an infection in the sigmoid as well as in the colon because of the inferior mesenteric vein as well as the portal vein, which is mainly connected to the liver. The portal vein is most commonly takes a transmission through liver because of streamline effect, as well as the portal vein is in a direct continuation with the right branch and to the largest area of the liver, that is the right lobe. Therefore, the right lobe is most commonly affected. It is mostly over the posterior superior surface, okay? And there can be a single loculation effect or a multiloculation effect, okay? So the next question, ma'am, how much percentage of people will get single loculated or a multiloculated thing? That is your question, right? Because you have to always start differentiating things and have some range of probability of getting infection in particular region, okay? Always keep that in mind. Whatever happens, if the patient gets a disease and the patient goes for death, how much percentage of people goes for death? How much percentage of paper patient will be surviving? That is your question and that should be your questioning ability. So therefore, in amoebic liver abscess, we can see 70% of the cases usually will have a single large abscess and 30% of the cases will have multiple loculations, okay? And it can be involving both the lobes, okay? If a patient has multiple loculated abscesses, okay? Therefore, we always conclude that the patient has a poor prognosis. A good prognosis can be defined only if it is a very small and early abscess of amoebiasis. It's always a very good prognosis if you do a proper treatment at proper time, okay? So, why we see a life cycle and as well as the pathogenesis of what is happening because of this transmission. There is a mature cyst, also called as quadrinucleated cyst, okay? What happens? It travels through a food or a water, okay? Therefore, what I do? I go to a place, I do not know what is the water is containing. I take the tumbler of water and start drinking the water which is containing the mature cyst. As well as I'm also taking a biryani. Okay, I think most of people like biryani. I don't like biryani, but I'm saying I'm taking a biryani which is having a contamination of this mature cyst. I'm going to ingest that food as well as the water. After ingestion, that passes through inside the stomach, okay, without damaging. It just enters the stomach in an alkaline medium. Cyst wall gets ruptured by the trypsin. Okay, so I have ingested inside stomach, it has got ruptured. So now what happens? It becomes and release. After the rupture, there will be a release, right? So now the rupture has caused the release and therefore there is a formation of metacystic trophozytes, okay? So what happens? The habitat is most commonly seen in the crypts. There is a crypt of the cecum where they go and start habitating. Commonly, that is the most common place, okay? Often the sigmoid colon, where they start forming their own trophozytes, okay? After forming their own trophozytes, as we know earlier, once there is a transmission of a particular disease, a particular area, that area becomes inflamed, okay? Therefore, we can see the cecum starts getting inflamed and this condition is also called as amoebic typhitis, okay? Itis means inflammation, okay? This starts secreting a proteolytic enzyme which will cause a flask-shaped ulcers. So, your next key question will be, in the transmission of entema histolytica, therefore, we can see in cecum, there is an inflammation of the cecum called as amoebic typhitis. That could be a question for you, Amy. And second question can be flask-shaped ulcers, which is the organism causing this flask-shaped ulcers. You can always think about the entema histolytica. Okay, so now we can see the cecum is affected, sigmoid is affected. Okay, so we'll think about cecum. Okay. So cecum is mainly affected and it may enter through the superior mesenteric vein and portal vein. Okay. In cecum also it is affected because of the help of inferior mesenteric vein. Therefore, these both together enter into the portal vein and therefore they reach the liver. I have already told you the portal vein has a direct connection to the right branch of the liver. And also we know that the largest area is the right lobe of the liver, which is getting affected most commonly. And therefore, now the patient meets with an amoebic hepatitis and therefore there is a formation of amoebic liver abscess. So now we can see the diagram, right? I think you all can see it. There is a matured cyst. See, you can see a matured cyst and it has got into the body. Now it has got broken up, there is a rupture, and now there is a release. After release, that particular organism enters the body and there is a trophozoite formation, right? After trophozoite formation, there is a multiplication. Always think of in multiplication, there could be an entire trophozoite ready to get infected, okay? And it is going to infect your particular area like cecum and sigmoid, okay? So this multiplication will also cause again a cyst, again it goes inside, and then it's getting released in your feces, okay? So this is how. So the third point is the trophozoite, which is going to be inside the crypts of the cecum, is called as colonization. Okay, it's getting colonized inside the body. But the cyst which you're going to release in the feces is going to be again a carrier for the other people. It could be a contamination for some other people's food or water. Okay, the next thing will be amoebic liver abscess. It is initially infected in the sigmoid or the ileocecal region. It enters the liver through portal vein. Okay, there usually you should always think about the trophozoites. So usually people tell the trophozoite action is like a cytolytic action. Okay, therefore it is also called as a cytolytic agent because of the release of histiolysin by destroying the hepatocytes. That's why they tell trophozoites destroy the hepatocytes by releasing histiolysin, and it is also a cytolytic agent. Okay, so now if you have got infected, trophozoite has entered into the liver and there is a process of multiple or a single abscess formation in the right lobe of the liver. Okay, so after the formation of all these things, what happens exactly inside the liver is it leads to liquefactive necrosis and thrombosis of blood vessels, and there can also be a release and breakage of the RTCs. Okay, and usually always think of once there is an abscess formation. Okay, we can always see there is liquefactive necrosis. Okay, that is a resulting factor. Along with that, we can also see a thrombosis of blood vessels and RBC contents. Okay. So, okay, now what I'm saying is, now we have, you can ask me a question right now, like a person, like a normal, my UG people used to ask so many questions like, ma'am, why this happens and why this not happens, okay? So now your question can be like, why there is a release of RBC and why there's a breakage of RBC and what is going to be in the resulting factor, okay? So if there is going to be a thrombosis and thrombosis of blood vessels as well as there's a release and breakage of RBC, we can always think about there is some, that is an infected liver abscess, okay? So you can't be expecting a sterile one. So therefore, now we can see, because of the breakage of the RBCs, okay, and the necrosis, liquefactive necrosis, we can always expect a different kind of a drainage from the abscess. And usually people call it as an anchovy sauce pus, okay? So now the most important equation again comes up, what is an anchovy sauce? See, I'll tell you, anchovy sauce is a sauce prepared from a type of fish, okay? Not in India, okay? Probably not in India, you can see in some other places, maybe, I was probably thinking it should be in China or Japan. I read it somewhere like it should be in China or Japan. Okay? So they use an anchovy sauce, which is mainly made up of fish. Okay, so it mimics like an anchovy sauce. Therefore, once you drain it, you can see, you can match it with an anchovy sauce. So the amoebic liver abscess, there is a formation of anchovy sauce pus, which is also known as chocolate brown colored pus. And it contains a dead liver cells and then broken RBCs, necrotic materials. But the problem is, no, once you drain it, there is no smell at all. So therefore, it is odorless. Okay, for example, I'm telling, the drainage is almost greenish in color. What could be the reason? Okay, your thinking should be green, comes to your mind is always bile. Okay, so therefore, this anchovy sauce gets mixed up with the bile and therefore it shows a color of green. Okay, is secondary infection is common in these people? Yes, in 30% of the patients only, we can see the secondary infections. Okay, in secondary infections, what are the causative organisms? First, initially, we had Enzema histolytica, right? That is a primary infection. Secondary infection can also be because of the E. coli, staphylococcus, and strepto. Okay, which is most commonly occurring in 30% of the patients. Okay, therefore, this is going to cause a pyogenic liver abscess feature. Okay, now we're going to get confused in a patient. For example, I get a patient in my OPD stating that he has an abscess in the liver and he has a symptom of pyogenic liver abscess as well as he's also mimicking like an amoebic liver abscess. Always, if you see a patient like that, think that the patient has got a secondary infection of the amoebic liver abscess. Okay, so what happens is that, okay, because of the secondary infection, the patient's liver go to a perihepatitis and therefore this liver get fixed to the diaphragm or the abdominal wall. Okay, therefore there is an action of hyperemia in the diaphragm causing a sympathetic pleural effusion on the right side. As we know, in all human beings, the liver is in the right side, and if the patient has at all a liver on the left side, it is called the situs inversus. Okay, so most commonly the patients
are having liver on the right side. Therefore, the fixativity occurs to the right diaphragm and the right side of the abdominal wall. Therefore, there is a reactionary pleural effusion seen on the right side only. Okay. Therefore, the patient coming with you with amoebic liver abscess with primary or secondary infection will have only pleural effusion on the right side, not on the left side. Okay. That is the most common clue for you in your big question. Okay. So, commonly amoebic abscess present as an acute entity, but it can also present as a chronic type because of the encapsulation and there is a dormitory for a longer time. Okay. And if there is a long-standing pus or abscess or a broken RBCs, you can always see a presence of calcification also. Okay. What are the causes and sequelae of this amoebic liver abscess? Always now we have understood an abscess or a cavitational content can rupture, right? So the amoebic liver abscess initially can rupture into the lung, leading to an expectoration of chocolate colored sputum, resulting in natural regression of abscess, which is the commonest site of rupture. The second is going to be a rupture into the peritoneum, causing peritonitis, which requires emergency laparotomy. So it's an emergency case for a surgeon. So there is any rupture in the peritoneum, we think of peritonitis, then we just go inside the OT and then we start an emergency laparotomy. In pleural cavity, it causes empyema. In bronchus, it's going to cause a bronchopleural fistula, leading to an anchovisous coughing out. So the patient is going to cough out the anchovisous right now. So the rupture into the bare area of the liver causes a retroperitoneal abscess, excuse me. So next is the rupture into the intestines or to the skin. It will cause an amoebiasis cutis. Okay. What is the most dangerous complication seen in this rupture is, I think, what the rupture into the pericardial cavity causing a cardiac tamponade. So now comes an interesting scenario called as cardiac tamponade. What is cardiac tamponade? There is a fullness in the pericardium. Okay. That is like the patient has a minimal cardiomegaly. It is fine. The heart is having a stress. It is going to cause a like this is your heart, the fist of your hand is the heart, okay? This is the pericardium surrounding in it, okay? Now what happens, the cavity is getting filled up. You can see the cavity like this and the heart is like this. It is causing a pressurizing effect. So because of the pressurizing effect, we can see the heart is going to cause a pumping effect, which is going to be very less, okay? Because of the less pumping effect, the patient goes to a cardiac tamponade. In cardiac tamponade, we can see a condition called as Beck's triad. In Beck's triad, there are three conditions we can see, okay? The thing is, the patient has an hypotension as well as the patient has raised JVP, and third can be on auscultation, we can hear of muffled heart sounds. Okay, therefore, this is called as Beck's triad in cardiac tamponade. Therefore, always remember the most dangerous complication in rupture of amoebic liver abscess is the rupture into the pericardial cavity causing cardiac tamponade. Actually, the patient goes for cardiac tamponade will be having a high mortality. Therefore, it will be requiring an emergency thoracotomy as well as a pericardial decompression. The septicemia and liver failure can also occur in patients with amoebic liver abscess and cirrhosis. So, what are the clinical features you see in amoebic liver abscess? It is most common in males and the ratio is always 20:1. Okay, the patient gives a history of, ma'am, I got an attack of an amoebic dysentery. And there could be a history of amoebic dysentery as well as the patient may not tell the history of the amoebic dysentery. Usually, the patient presents with fever, loss of weight. The patient can also have chills and rigor. The patient can have a non-productive cough and a shoulder pain. Okay. So next is the pain can be in the right hypochondrium because the liver is in the right hypochondrium. Therefore, the patient gets a pain in the right hypochondrium. Okay. So what happens on palpation? You can see there is a softness in the abdomen. There is a tenderness present in the right hypochondrium, and there is a smooth surface. And therefore, sometimes you can see a palpation of an hepatomegaly. Okay. That is an increased liver. Okay. Size of the liver is increased. Okay. Next, you can also see an usual clinical sign is the patient sometimes can have an intercostal tenderness. The intercostal tenderness happens only if there is a secondary infection and there is a rupture of the amoebic liver abscess. Okay. The patient also gives like a symptom of yellowishness of the sclera, yellowishness of the skin. Okay. Therefore, this gives a conclusion of the patient has a mild jaundice, which is uncommon in cirrhotic patients, and there can be multiple abscess, which will be a poor prognosis to us. Okay. So in acute cases, what are the things you're going to see? The patient will be telling you, or you can see tenderness, you can see rigidity and skin edema in the right hypochondrium. It is mainly seen in the acute cases. How it differentiates from the chronic cases, the chronic amoebic liver abscess will be smooth, firm or hot, and it will be a non-tender liver. Always remember, if it is a primary infection, the liver can be a tender and can be a very painful one for the acute cases only. And in chronic cases, we can always see that there is a non-tender liver and therefore the skin edema may not be seen. And you can also see a firmer heart consistency liver on palpation. So therefore, in clinical features, I'll always think about two things in amoebic liver abscess. Primary can be acute and secondary will be chronic. In primary, the patient is an acute amoebic liver abscess. Therefore, patient presents with high fever, chills, rigor, tender and soft palpable liver with intercostal tenderness. Okay. In chronic, you'll always think about the patient presents with firm or hard in consistency, smooth, or else the patient will have a non-tender palpable liver without any acute features. Okay. So what are the features? The features systematically or systematic thing you will just think of is usually patient will present with fever, chills, rigor, loss of appetite, and then reduced weight and jaundice. So this is the most common features you should think about. The systemic Usually we can see systemic is most commonly seen in both acute and chronic conditions. Okay. Acute, usually acute means the primary infection, chronic means the secondary infection. Okay. So abnormal features. Okay. Always you think of abnormal features like pain and tenderness in the right hypochondrium. And then you can always think about a localized guarding and rigidity on abdominal examination. Sometimes even you can feel a mass in the right upper abdomen, that is the right hypochondrium. You can see a mass. The patient will have fluid thrill. Okay, shifting of fluid dullness, you can see it is mainly seen in ascites or any fluid collection. So the most important thing is there is an ascites present in this patient. The patient also has a splenomegaly in the amoebic liver abscess. So what is the most common thoracic feature you want to see in this amoebic liver abscess? The patient can have a dry cough, a pain in the right lower part. Okay, this pain usually present on the right side, that is because of the diaphragmatic or a pleural irritation. The patient will also have a right shoulder pain. Okay, the right shoulder pain is because of diaphragmatic irritation. And you can also see a pleural effusion most commonly on the right side. Okay, the next thing is because of the irritation or because of any collection, the patient can have an intercostal tenderness. Okay, so what are the features of complications if these things goes for a rupture? The abscess going for rupture, again getting secondary infection, and going to finally cause septicemia as well as liver failure. These are the most important four complications that you will see in amoebic liver abscess. Okay, fine. I'm saying there's a pain in the right hypochondrium. What else you can think of? We can think of cholecystitis, okay, cholelithiasis. And the next thing you're going to think of is the hepatocellular carcinoma. Okay, that is a very rare condition. You can see the age criteria for HCC. Okay, cholecystitis has a criteria. Okay, and then the last DD for acute type can be a subphrenic abscess. Okay, so the patient is going to be having a chronic amoebic liver abscess. It will always make like a hematoma in every aspect. Okay, so chronic always have a very big like hematoma, like a mimicking character. Okay. The investigation, what you're going to see, the total count can be raised. Okay, it is increased. The LFT also shows an altered bilirubin and albumin level. So what happens to the prothrombin time? Okay, it is getting widened because there is a lot of breakage of RBCs. So there is a mixing of blood inside your body. So therefore, immediately give injection vitamin K, 10 mg, IM for 5 days so that the patient is having a proper... So what is the effect of vitamin K? You can think about the effect of clotting of blood. Okay, even if there is a PT, it remains widened. Okay, FFP can be given because there is a loss of blood somewhere. So we have to stop the draining of blood somewhere in the body. Okay, the serum alkaline phosphatase, SGPT, SGOT are the main important enzymatic levels of the liver, which is also going to be altered. So the non-invasive procedure, radiological procedure, is an ultrasound abdomen. Okay, it shows an altered echogenicity, which can be anechoic or hypoechoic, and then the size, location, the number of abscess, and the nature of the liver gets altered in the patient because of the amoebic liver abscess. X-ray, what they will show, there is a tenting of the fixation of the right diaphragm. Okay, as well as patient can have a right pleural effusion, and there can be some soft tissue shadow on the right hypochondrium. Okay, so the next investigation is there is an indirect heme agglutination test, which is 95% positive rate. ELISA and DEL diffusion precipitative test are also a reliable serological test. Okay, the serological tests are reliable in non-endemic areas than the endemic areas. Okay, so the reliability stands in both areas. So the CT, what the CT shows? The CT gives a proper raised diaphragm. It also shows an abscess cavity where you can see the size, location, number of the abscess, whether there is any presence of pleural effusion on the right side, there is a change on the liver. As well as you can also do a sigmoidoscopy and colonoscopy for seeing an active ulcer. What kind of ulcer you're going to see? Flask-shaped ulcers because of the proteolytic effect. Okay. So during this seeing of this ulcers in the sigmoidoscopy and colonoscopy, you just start scraping the ulcer and then take it for testing. You can see the trophozoites of the entamoeba histolytica. So now you have confirmed it is amoebic liver abscess and you have confirmed there is trophozoites of entamoeba histolytica. Now what is going to be the treatment? Okay, the treatment is nothing but metronidazole 800 mg TDS, that is 3 times a day, or injection metronidazole 500 mg IV TDS for 5 to 10 days. Okay, 5 days is the minimum portion where if it is an early entity. 10 days is the right regimen. Okay, people sometimes give a 5-10 days regimen, always go for 10 days one. Okay, metronidazole 600 mg BD dose for 5 days. Okay, so people don't get confused with that. The thing is metronidazole 800 mg TDS, or else if they're going to give an injection metronidazole 500 mg IV TDS, it should be for 10 days. Only metronidazole 600 mg BD can be given for 5 days, right? 2 times a day for 5 days you can give. Okay, so the patient is having a secondary infection. What you're going to do? You're going to give an IV or oral antibiotic to control the secondary infection. What are the antibiotics you can prefer in this people? Okay, these kind of people will always start giving ciprofloxacin, amoxicillin, and cefotaxime. Okay, usually if the patient has only small abscess, which is less than 3 centimeters, they respond to all these drugs. Okay, so other drugs we can give dihydroemetin. No, it is 1.5 mg per kg per day. IM for 5 days should be given for cardiac, under cardiac monitoring. Okay, and then chloroquine 250 mg twice a day for 10 to 14 days can be your next drug of choice. Okay, the drugs used for amoebic infection is always remember metronidazole, dimethyl. Okay, that is the most three is the most important three used. Okay, chloroquine, tetracycline can be the next thing of usage. Okay, so always remember the patient gets an amoebic liver abscess in an early pregnancy. Can you give metronidazole? No. Okay, so metronidazole is not given the first trimester of pregnancy. This is also a need question. So, because like what you can say, the teratogenic effect can be seen on metronidazole, if it is given first trimester, that could be your thinking. Please have the same thinking that you should not give this drug in first trimester because there is no proven theory of what is going to happen to the baby. Okay, because the impotence happens within less than 8 weeks, right? So within 8 weeks, don't ever try to give metronidazole for any pregnant women. Okay, better if you want to have any clarity among the treatment, even go for aspiration, don't go for metronidazole oral management. In case of large abscess or infected abscess, aspiration with the wide bore needle is always advisable under USG guidance. Okay, and then previously without USG guided aspiration has been done by passing needle in the sixth intercostal space in the mid axillary line. Always remember, this is a clavicle, this is a mid clavicular line, and if it is an axilla, we will have a mid axillary line. So the right sixth intercostal mid axillary line, we are going to pass a needle and then we are going to do an aspiration of the particular abscess. Okay, there is also a condition called as percutaneous drainage. Okay, under the ultrasonic guidance, the pigtail catheter is placed into the abdominal, like in the abdomen where there is an abscess. Okay, in the abscess cavity, we are going to give the pigtail catheter percutaneously to drain the pus. Okay, this catheter tube and abscess cavity has to be washed and irrigated at regular intervals with a normal saline. It may fail, okay, because if there is any thick pus or if there is multiloculation, there is more than one or two, okay, pockets, it's called as multiloculation abscess or multiple abscess, it will usually fail. Therefore, you cannot wash properly and you cannot drain it down, you cannot be keeping in a sterile tube. The procedure will cause a side effect called as bleeding and infection. As we know, anywhere you prick is going to cause bleeding. The second thing is, anywhere you're going to disturb the primary infection, you can go for a secondary infection. Okay, the aspirin fluid is sent for cousin sensitivity, cytology, and also for the study of trophozoites of the entamoebohistolytica. Okay, so next is, when you're going to do surgery for this patient, when you're going to do surgery for this patient. Even after repeated aspiration, if the abscess cavity gets filled up again and again, okay, and next is, the patient is having a very thick pus, as we think of an any abscess in the IND procedure. Okay, the next is going to be multiloculated abscess. Okay, therefore, on multiloculations, only few loculated abscess we can drain, and then we can even just remove or aspirate. Okay, in multiloculations, what happens, the remaining three, more than three, you can't be draining off, therefore the patient needs a always surgery. Okay, left lobe abscess, because of a danger of rupture in the pericardial cavity, those abscess you have to immediately do a surgery. Okay, if the patient has a ruptured abscess, okay, immediately take the patient for emergency laparotomy and then see that the rupture is immediately corrected. Okay, a cardiac lobe abscess, because it is mainly present in the posterior side, it's going to cause a realistic problem for us. And the patient has a multiple abscess, then it is an indication for surgery. What are you going to do? You're going to do a peritoneal approach, where the abscess area is open and then the pus is evacuated. Okay, a Mallinckrodt catheter is placed and brought out through a separate stab incision. Okay, the catheter is kept in situ until the drainage stops completely. The complete drainage of pus will be confirmed by repeated ultrasonography. During this drainage, always advise that the patient should not take alcohol. Okay, the next is going to be chloroquine 250 mg BD for 10 days. And then the patient also can go for diloxin fluoride 500 mg TDS, which will be given for 10 to 14 days. Okay, what will be the complication of surgery? Initially, it is because of the anesthetic problem will occur because of the anesthesia. Second thing, you can always think about a bleeding because you're going to anyway operate the patient. Third thing, the patient is a chronic alcoholic with liver cirrhosis, the patient can go for liver failure. Okay, and the next thing is, the patient can go for intrahepatic abscess formation. Okay, sorry, intraperitoneal abscess formation. Sorry, it's already hepatic one. So this is going to be from intrahepatic to an intraperitoneal abscess formation. Okay, and sometimes because of all these things, the patient can have a bile leak causing bile peritonitis and fistula. Okay, what happens after all the surgery? Patient is fine. Okay, at what intervals you have to check the patient again and again? The follow-up is done at regular intervals. Okay, measures are taken and proper counseling to avoid alcohol and repeating of your liver function test and ultrasonography to confirm complete resolution of the abscess cavity. So this is going to be the most important topic on amoebic liver abscess. Okay, so we'll have a short summary. Okay, if you don't mind. Okay, I think I have finished the class so early, so we can have a short summary. So the thing is, today's topic is on amoebic liver abscess. The neat important short notes: amoebiasis is mainly a disease also known as a tropical abscess. It is mainly seen in option A, tropical areas; option B, developing countries; option C, developing countries. The organism causing center by histolytica. It is endemic in Mexico, Africa, and India. Okay, the people who are affected are cirrhotic patients, which can be because of alcoholism or non-alcoholism, and alcoholic patients are most commonly affected. The most common presentation, extra intestinal presentation of amoebiasis, is always an amoebic liver abscess. Okay, in Western countries, you can always see less amoebic liver abscess cases, and you can see more pyogenic liver abscess cases. Okay, in developing countries and in endemic countries, we can always see only amoebic liver abscess rather than the pyogenic abscess. Okay, always, if you think about a liver abscess, if you drain the amoebic liver abscess, it can be sterile most of the time, unless it is infected. Okay, the trophozoites are most commonly seen on the walls of the abscess. Okay, it mostly affects the cecum. It's most affected the cecum because of the SMV, and then sigmoid colon is mainly affected because of the IMV. Portal vein is the most common channel for infecting the liver. 70% of the cases will have single large abscess, and 30% of the cases will have a multiple abscess. Okay, always, if the patient has a multiple abscess, there is a poor prognosis. Okay, I'm going to ingest the contaminated food or water. It enters the stomach, where it gets ruptured, it gets released. Therefore, there's a formation of trophozoite. It is also seen in the thrips of the cecum, where there is a formation of trochus, right? And there is a presence of flask-shaped ulcers because of the proteolytic enzyme effect. Okay, and then enters the liver through the portal vein, and then it is going to cause an amoebic liver abscess in the right lobe of the liver most probably. Okay, so the next important thing you should think about is anchovy sauce. First, okay, it is a chocolate brown color which contains a dead liver cell, RBC, and necrotic material, as well as it is odorless. Okay, the pathology usually you can think of secondary infection. It can be because of E. coli, Staphylococcus, and Streptococcus. Okay, usually in secondary infection, patient presents with features of pyogenic liver abscess. Okay, the next thing is sequence is that it can rupture into lung, pericardial cavity, which is the most dangerous complication. It can rupture in the peritoneum, which will cause peritonitis, and therefore the patient can be taken to OT for an emergency laparotomy. Okay, and there can be rupture to the pleural cavity causing empyema. There can be rupture in the bronchus causing bronchopleural fistula. Okay, therefore the patient vomits and anchovy sauce pus, and then intestine or skin, it causes amoebiasis cutis. Okay, the most common dangerous complication is pericardial rupture. As we know, this is the most important thing. Acute and chronic, two critical features are there. Okay, therefore always think of an acute. If there is a primary infection, think of chronic and secondary infection. Abnormal features, as we know, body rigidity, pain, syndromes in the right hypochondria. There can be pleural effusion as well as pain in the right shoulder tip. Rupture, infection, septicemia, and liver failure, the four important complications. And then the most important thing is treatment part. In this whole system, MGBD is for 5 days. Ametronidazole is always come for a 10-day regimen. Okay, we can also do a percutaneous drainage as well as surgery is indicated for a multilocated abscess and then ruptured abscess. And then the procedure is going to be through a transperitoneal approach, and then abscess is going to be drained and varicose catheter is going to be placed. And then we're going to do our best to save the patient, and there should be no complication in the surgery. If at all, if it comes, it can be a bleeding and liver failure. The follow-up is much more important for all these cases. So thank you everyone for your calm and happy listening. So I thank everyone for this class. Okay, and I'll just see you on some other day with a different topic. Okay, bye. Chalo, bye.